Welcome to the 14th lecture of the online lecture series on language, literature, and cultural studies organized by the English Language Teachers Interaction Forum, ELTIF. Let me introduce myself. I'm Dr. Praveen, coordinator of the online programs of ELTIF. Now, Dr. Lena, who's a teacher and active member of ELTIF, will brief you about the programs of ELTIF.
English Language Teachers Interaction Forum is an organization meant for empowering less privileged. It's a dynamic group of learners, teachers, teacher educators, academicians, and educational consultants working in an educational sector of rural India since it was established in 2002. ELTIF relentlessly tries to operate English language as a novel, innovative, and powerful tool to bring changes in the lives of the most needy and neglected people in the society. ELTIF provides academic training to the teachers, catering to their individual professional development needs. ELTIF conducts workshops and English enrichment programs for learners with a view to helping them gain their academic needs and aspirations. ELTIF prepares children for the 21st century life. Our mission is empowering rural India through English language education. ELTIF reaches where the current education system fails and supports children of different parts of India to fulfill their dreams and to explore their potentials. Social commitment of this organization took us to Kannur Central Jail to conduct programs for the inmates of prison, which really instilled a fantabulous spirit and energy among us to go ahead with such social endeavors. We often conduct programs for tribal people and tribal villages, especially Kannavam in Kannur district. We are not driven by any kind of material gains, but we have a bond of passion for education and thrive for self-love service. Besides these, ELTIF has been regularly organizing international and national conferences. ELTIF has been published a quarterly journal of ELTIF with ISSN number promptly and regularly for the last 10 years. Now, ELTIF have ventured into virtual world with an online lecture series. Thank you.
Today's speaker is Professor H. Kalpana of Pondicherry University. She will lecture on the pedagogical aspects of teaching fiction in the second language classroom. Dr. Kartika, a former student of Dr. Kalpana and now a faculty of NIT Trichy, will formally introduce the speaker.
Good evening, everyone. It's indeed a pleasure to introduce another teacher of mine to all of you. So without wasting any time, let me just get into that. Dr. H. Kalpana, an eminent scholar in literary studies, is the present head of the Department of English at Pondicherry Central University. She has more than two decades of experience into teaching and researching. A recipient of the prestigious Shastri Indo-Canadian Institute's Graduate Research Award, she was affiliated to the University of Alberta, Canada, where she was mentored by Professor Stephen Slevin, an eminent post-colonial critic, as some of you may know. She received her doctorate in 1996 for the thesis entitled Reshaping the Self, Feminine Identity in the Short Stories of Alice Munro and Shashi Deshpande. She has bagged many awards, including the Shastri Indo-Canadian Award, which I have already mentioned, Visiting Researcher Award from the University of Gothenburg, Sweden, United States Fulbright Award, just to name a few. Besides receiving similar awards and honors, several of them, she has a number of publications to her credit, including a book titled Quilting Relationships, A Cruise Through Comparative Literary Studies. A passionate teacher, very empathetic in nature, and a literary critic, Dr. H. Kalpana is also fond of music, nature, and all things great and small. Indeed, it's a pleasure, ma'am. The floor is open to you and over to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. A very good evening and namaste. In fact, it has been a great pleasure having you all here. I would rather, you know, not have had that bit of introduction towards me, because I generally think that all those came only because of my passion towards literature. And also the fact that I enjoy doing literature. I am a person who thinks that, you know, being a good teacher and being a good researcher is more important than any other accolades. And those follow just because, you know, you have the passion towards it. That is the reason why initially I just given a one line bio note, but in spite of that, anyway, it ended up with this long note. Today, I'll be looking a little into using a particular novel. I'll be looking at how we indulge in teaching it in a classroom, so that quite a few of you benefit from this in case you do want to teach. As you know, most of you think teaching is not a very easy thing, even though everybody thinks, you know, going and teaching a novel in a class or a short story in a class is a simple thing. That's what everybody thinks, that you just go and tell a few things and you finish with that text. But in fact, it involves a lot of involvement and work behind the scene, because you cannot just teach anything without a kind of context or a background, especially in humanities and literature teaching. Be it fiction, be it drama, be it poetry, you do need to build up a lot of context, because you're teaching students of literature the reality of life using various kinds of texts. So it's not, you know, easy to just say that, you know, all right, this is what the text means. You just use it and write an examination. That's not the point. Because I've been reiterating, those of you who have been in my classes, I think you will know this, that, you know, 10 years later, 20 years later, who is bothered about what happened in the Night of the Scorpion poem? Or, you know, who's interested in Jhumpa Lahiri's, you know, The Interpreter of Maladies? Because you do not even remember the characters, you don't remember the names. Some 15, 20 years later, what will stand in your mind is basically how do you deal with a particular conflict in your life. And it may not be that the books directly or the stories or the poetry directly tell you something, but subconsciously something from there remains in your mind, and that is what you utilize at that particular moment. And that is what I keep telling students all the time, that when we teach, it is more to do with the mechanism by which we inculcate a kind of strategy by which they are able to use some of the matters that are there in the text or in the literature to rethink their own lives or relationships or, you know, resolutions that they would like to make in their lives. So it should work for them for the future of their life, not because of the bookish knowledge that the work is going to give them. So based on this background, today I'll be giving this particular talk. I hope you find it interesting. And let us hope that, you know, I stick to the 1 hour time limit that I do have. If by chance I think I'm overshooting, I might skip one or two slides here and there. Okay, so the title that I've given today is Pedagogical Aspects of Teaching. Fiction in the Second Language Classroom. Even though I've given the title with using the second language classroom, I won't be stressing too much on that. Moreover, I also would like to say that in the beginning, that I generally teach, you know, postgraduate students. That's my background. And so for me to go into a level lower than that is a bit difficult, in the sense, maybe undergraduate and postgraduate teaching, that is where I would place my whole discussion with. And I would be looking at that. But if there are other questions, then let us look at that. So let me start with the question of pedagogy. What do we mean by pedagogy? You see, the words pedagogical, I'm looking at the title I've given you, and I'm going back to, you know, look at the words that I've given there. Interestingly enough, the words pedagogical, pedagogy, and pedagogue, all three come from the same root. And this is from the dictionary, okay? I've not taken anything outside it. And pedagogical and its cognate present us with an example of how different words, you know, can come from the same root, but they can also mean different things for us. So when we look at these three words, they come from the Greek term paidagogos, and interestingly enough, it meant a slave who used to take the children to school. So you see, when we look at it, it's very interesting. It doesn't mean tutor or teaching. But a little later, both the words pedagogical and pedagogy got related to the idea of teaching and teachers. Whereas pedagogue took a very negative tone because it also started meaning somebody who is dull and boring. See, similarly, the word pedant, which means, you know, a tutor, now actually in a way it makes the idea that one who constructs knowledge or who makes knowledge. So you again look at it as somebody who is not very positive in the sense of a very negative connotation. And the word pedantic, relating to teaching, is more commonly used to mean now being dull and unimaginative when we teach. So I just wanted you to understand that when we use the word pedagogical here, we are looking at it from the angle of, you know, how do we actually teach in a classroom? How do we manipulate, you know, the process of rendering a communication between the teacher and the students? So that is where I would place today's discussion on. Now, when we look at second language learning, second language learning is connected to the activity related to learning a second language. It's something outside your native language. So whatever you talk at home, your mother tongue, besides that, the next language that you learn, be it English or Hindi or any other language, could become a second language. Of course, in the context of India, it has become to some extent a reference to English. So second language learning involves the process of, you know, acquiring a second language, which is of course referred to in ELT as L2 or target language, and as opposed to L1, which is the native or the mother tongue. And since I said English is predominantly used in India as a second language, I've utilized it in the title to look at it, because the things that we teach, we are teaching it to people who have acquired the language. It's not their mother tongues, maybe a small group of people for whom it may be a mother tongue, but normatively in the general sense, at least 98% of people who have English as an acquisition. Now I come to the third part of my title, fiction. Fiction in literature, when we look at the word fiction, it means something that is created from imagination, which is not fact. And that is the distinction that is made generally by history and literature, because history continuously extrapolates the idea that it is factual, whereas literature is imaginative. The fact is also literature is, do not forget this, whatever writer or you know, realm of people we talk about who are writing fiction, generally it is a construct, a fabrication, and it could be based on a true event, on experiences that are, you know, gathered, or on a situation or an incident. Even though there is this whole talk that literature reflects the reality of life, to some extent I don't think that it is so true, because it does to a large extent create a kind of environment in which it tries to fit in an imaginative sphere. In fiction, of course, we have different kinds of subgenres. We call the novel, the short story, the novella. And the root word comes from fictio, that is the act of making, fashioning, or molding, and which I told you very, you know, in the beginning, that it is a kind of a construction. Now, wherever I have taken sources, then I have given the source also there. It is there in my PPT. Now, the question is that now, after I've cleared this things from my title, let me look at how do we teach fiction? I just gave you, for fun's sake, a cartoon where, you know, the guy is telling that, you know, he has not written the English literature test because he did not know the answer to Dickens, David Copperfield, and Oliver Twist. So you can see the fun there. And of course, this is somebody teaching Hamlet, and he's looking at Acts 1, 2, plus 3. And you know, everybody is just looking at him. He is using some kind of a model by which he's trying to tell this thing. Now, why I use these two cartoons was interestingly, normatively again. Whenever you see we go back to asking questions from our student, we end up asking them questions of the year in which a book was written, the year in which somebody was born, then you know, asking who wrote this particular text, who is this particular character, questions like that. They're not very thinking questions. So in the conventional method that we teach, normally, you know, I don't blame any teachers because we have never been given that basic background of how we need to go and teach fiction in a class. We have been taught for so many years. I still remember when I did my MA program and my UG program, I used to have teachers who come to class and would tell me the storyline of the text and give me a set of questions and say, these are the things that will come in the exam, so you do this. So I thought that was the way I should be doing it. But a little later, I also realized that, you know, just telling the summary of the story, telling who are the characters in the story, giving the narrative techniques, telling these are the literary devices that are used by the narrations, giving them important questions, telling, you know, you just understand these, so examine the significance of the title, examine, you know, this particular character in the novel, tell the plot structure of the novel. These are, you know, all indicate in some way a kind of passive learning. So they do not in any way create a communication. It's a one-sided communication where the teacher blurts out a number of things and the students on the other side gather a large amount of things and they utilize it probably just to write one particular examination or gain a degree, and after that the whole process is over. So to some extent, how do we change that is the question that I have today. How do we actually employ methods by which we can change this act of teaching? Now, you know, one of the things that I would like to begin with is I'm looking today at this case study of looking at Jane Eyre, simply because it's a text that I teach generally in class. And also because I thought most people would have read it. That's the reason I used it, because I did not think that we had enough time asking all of you to read one novel and then go back to discussing it. Now, one of the interesting things that strikes anybody who looks at Jane Eyre, I don't know if any of you have Googled the text on a website, but if you do, you will see that, you know, look at the images that I'm putting across for you. The text has so many different images that are there on the title page of the book. They're innumerable. In fact, I've just collected a few here. And the reason that, you know, there are so many of these various models of, you know, images itself is a question. Why is it that, you know, the texts have so many different versions or images that are put up on the screen? For example, look at this. This only has a window. It doesn't have anything more than that. So we, you know, one of the first questions, if I do enter a class or I'm going to look at it, is I would ask, you know, maybe the students to start asking or finding out why probably there are this many images. Why is it that each of the publications was using different ones? And the reason is, you know, could be different because one of them, you know, at least a couple of them could be talking about an e-book. And so one needs to make that attractive. Something is attracting to a higher model of intellectual capacity. For example, the one that I've put here, the first one, which has a kind of a graphic picture of a woman looking at something. This is the one that I'm talking to you about. This particular one is a hard copy, and it is also way higher in price compared to the others. So you see that I would start by asking students to start looking at this and finding out why probably there are different models and you know, different images. So we are looking at this kind of, you know, trying to imagine why these models are there. And as I told you, these are only some that I've picked up. If you go and there are lots more interesting studies. You know, small project where they want to look at, you know, the cover pages of books that are there, they'll find this very interesting. And you would also find to a certain extent, you know, something like a book like Jhumpa Lahiri's, you know, Interpreter of Maladies. If you looked at that, the book had different covers in different places. If it was in US, it had a different cover. In Canada, it had a different cover. So even sometimes, you know, national images play a part in the cover pages of books. Now, after this work is done, I'll start with looking at the basic techniques of, you know, any kind of novel or writing that we look at. What is a plot? So what is a plot is a question that we have to ask again the students to find out what is a plot structure. Now, of course, this is an easy answer because it's an arrangement of events and it's an imagined view of a series of events. You know that, you know, any book, the plot is that there is an arrangement that has been done. And in fact, in Jane Eyre, again, you know, the statement is that the novel follows the story of Jane, who is, of course, plain and simple, and she battles through life struggles. And then, you know, the story also says that Jane has many obstacles. It's just an outline. Since it's there on the PPT, I do not want to read because it's not good to read whatever has been written there. So we are looking at this kind of a structure where, you know, we are looking at this imagined series of events that are coming. Now, the question that you should also be asking the students to think is that, why do you think it is, you know, the series is like this? Why do you think we start with the girl being in Mrs. Reed's house? Why cannot we start with Jane starting in the school? What is the necessity for the Reed's home actually? Why? What is the reason for from Lowood School for her movement into Rochester's house? Is there any reason for that? So you see, when you ask these questions, then the students restart to think about the arrangements of the events. They may even come up with questions like, probably, you know, it would have been better if the whole story started in the school and the part in the house of Mrs. Reed might not have been very important. So we see that, you know, that this arrangement that has been given to us, we can also progress by telling the students that this, of course, after all these questionings are done and this kind of, you know, discussion is done, we can lead them to explain that this is a kind of chronology. And the chronology is because of a particular thing that the novel is trying to do, which in one of the later slides I will bring up. So we start with this. We start with what is the question with regard to the plot. Then we look at the point of view. Who's telling the story? Where is this particular individual located? What is the vision or perspective and the individual vis-a-vis the society is trying to show to us? I will just show you just a couple of minutes from the film here, just to give you a perspective about who tells the story and the way it is told.
I was glad of it. I never liked long walks, especially on chilly afternoons.
John, dear,
just one to start with.
And one for you, Georgiana.
Oh, thank you, Mama.
And one for my darling Eliza.
Thank you, Mama. Thank you.
You are hungry after your play.
Bessie, why did you let them stay out so late? A minute more and they would have been caught in the rain.
Well, it was that Jane, Mum. I called and called, but she'd gone off on her own and I couldn't find her anywhere.
Of course. You may go, Bessie.
What does Bessie say I have done, Aunt Reed?
A child must not take up her elders. Until you can speak pleasantly, remain silent.
Okay, I used this particular video because I thought I wanted you to tell you that when you looked at the story is being told by Jane. And you can also see that, you know, the Jane is outside the picture of the normative family. If you looked at the very first scenario, she is not there. And in fact, even in the book, the whole vision or the sketch that is provided to you is of this girl who is not participating in the family picture of the mother with the three children, and she's not there. A little later, you see, I didn't pick up this, but if you look at the video also and in the book too, after she sits down in the library, she's not sitting in the normal space of, you know, sitting in a chair, but she sits in the windowsill where, you know, she is secluded and she's estranged, she's isolated. And that's when you see that John Reed comes searching for her to find out what she's doing. So I'm not going into detail with this. So the point of view that the story tells you, interestingly, is that, you know, it is trying to move you from this idea of moving ahead with trying to, you know, process. One second, I think, yeah. So, you know, it is trying to tell you that Jane Eyre, this is the title that is there in the Gutenberg site. And if you look at this, what is the point of view that you get is that it is an autobiography. The minute you read it as an autobiography, interestingly enough, the whole story sets itself to tell you that it is the first person narrative, which also now brings the question that you can ask in the class, that is a first person narrative reliable? Do you think that the person who's telling the story tells that everything to you very correctly? You can also ask questions like whether is this a flashback or is it happening at the moment that it has been happening? If it is happening at the moment as it is in the storyline that we look at, do you think that Jane has that much of vocabulary to tell you the story as it is? If the story is being written, who's writing the story? And why is it that, you know, repeatedly there are statements like the reader in the storyline? And then does Jane try to in any way create something in your mind, some kind of emotional quotient in the mind of the readers by addressing the reader repeatedly in the novel? So you see that we end up with a large number of these questions when we look at the point of view. Now, mind you, as I told you, this also means some amount of work because you also have to look at what was the very, very title that was given for the novel in the initial stages. How did, you know, the Bronte bring out that title and how did she utilize it within the perspective of the novel? Then you see, we also look at characterization. This is the third thing that we look at. Who are the characters in the novel? How are they sketched for us? What is the implications of this? Do we get a picture in our mind about these characters? Do we understand what kind of qualities do they have? I'm just giving you one example from the novel about John Reed. The first time he is given to you, this is the kind of explanation or the background that is given, that John Reed was a schoolboy of 14 years old, 4 years older than I. And then look at the statement, large and stout for his age, with a dingy and unwholesome skin, thick lineaments in a spacious visage, heavy limbs and large extremities. Now, you know, if somebody has to do either a sketch or, you know, has to do a video, or do, you know, a film, then they have very clearly, you know, the picture of the person as to how he looks. And not only is it how, as to how he looks, but also look at the statement, he ought not have to be at school, but his mama and had taken him home for a month or two on account of his delicate health. So there's a construction that in spite of the fact that he looks heavy and strong, he is not having good health. And then there is also a statement that, you know, the master says that he would do very well if he had fewer cakes and sweetmeats. So we are getting the picture that he is a glutton, and which you saw also in the video, that he is trying to take something and the mother admonishes him. So we get a picture of the boy, and we get similar pictures in the story. So if you go back and look into the story, you have a large number of different people who come up to you. And I've just given you in the next slide caricatures of these people that have been done, taken from the book. They're just, you know, for giving you a break. So you can see Mr. Brocklehurst, you can see Helen Burns, you can see John Reed, all these from the book. And they're all coming out in this form because this is the way that it has been given to you in the book. Then the next part that we look at is the setting. Because the settings tell a lot to us. In fact, in this particular novel, the novel begins with the rain. And the rain is important because it tells you that Jane cannot go on a walk, nor can anybody go on a walk, which means that they are in a way imprisoned within a house. And that question of that imprisonment works throughout the novel to a large extent till almost the time that she enters into Rochester's house. Then you can see the window, which is again very important because it programs you to start thinking that Jane is alone. Then you have the library, which is filled with books, which also gives you the idea that she has a peace of mind reading books. Then you have the home, of course, the setting of the home, the Reed's home, then the school, then Rochester's home, then the Moors, then you have Cousin Reed, and all of them play an important role by giving you various phases by which she looks at, you know, the places that one is there. Again, you know, I just show you a short video to explain how the scenes in the book provide you, you know, with various kinds of backdrops. And these are all written from the book, the passages down. We look at this settings because they do give us a picture of, you know, various things that are happening at that particular time. They provide you, especially, you know, as I said, if it's a film like the one that I showed you just now, it gives you a lot more because it tells you about the Victorian settings, it tells you about the fireplace, it tells you the places that people sit in and the way they'll behave. So there's a lot more that comes from a visual, and the book utilizes all that by giving you the narration by which it uses it. So now we look at how to evaluate. You know, I gave you the normative things like the plot, the setting, the characters, all these, and how we make questions of these for the class and, you know, ask students to interact with us to give us their points of view, which also means to a certain extent we are inculcating in some way an interest in them to read. Because over and over again, there has been this problem that we are coming up with as teachers, that students do not read texts. Why do not they read the texts? The reason is that there are guidebooks, there are, you know, various now internet sources, which give them the background by which they can understand the whatever is the plot, the summary or the characters and, you know, write an exam. But when you make them start to think, I'm sure, even if not everybody in the class, quite a few would start reading. So now, besides the normal techniques that we are looking at, how do we evaluate different contexts? How do we make them, you know, look at the various questions of how do we evaluate the individuals? What kind of person, for example, is Jane? To start with this question, how do you look at her in the novel? Because she is the storyteller. Do you think that she is rebellious? Because in the beginning of the story, you saw that she was rebellious. Is it good for a child to be rebellious? And do you think in the context of today's society that a child asking this kind of questions would be considered as rebellion or not? Is she too self-centered? Do you think that throughout the novel, she only talks about herself? You don't get other people's pictures. And does that mean that, you know, she is continuously making herself more important than the others? Is there a kind of independence in her? Do you really feel that she's independent? Or, you know, is she trying to maneuver a method by which in that present settings or the Victorian settings, she's trying to get some kind of security for herself? Is she materialistic? Does she look for money? Do you think that she hankers for money? So, you know, these kinds of questions probably lead you to make a large number of references to, you know, who is this Jane and what kind of person is she? And I'm sure, you know, students would come up with a large number of strategies by which they think. You can also ask them to rethink. Let's say that, you know, you want to fashion a new kind of Jane. How would you like to fashion her? How would you like to configure her? And maybe it would be very interesting that students come up with different strategies by which they would think that they want a Jane who is like this. Then, you know, we also evaluate the social context. So we look at the society at that particular time. We look at the status of women at that time. And, you know, I have not put this, but, you know, I've taken it from somewhere. And the whole idea is that at that particular time that we looked at, there was a very clear demarcation about what a woman was and what a man was. Most often the woman was seen as somebody who belonged to the home. She was seen to be the wife, the mother, the daughter, or the sister. She was not seen to be somebody who could lead, you know, any kind of operation by which she would participate in public decisions. Her work was seen to be participating with the husband and the family. So this, of course, was a structure in the time. But there's also another thing that you also remember, you have to remember, that this was not the status of all women. There were women who came from the working class, and probably the status differed. Now, where would you place Jane here? Would she be from the upper middle class, the aristocracy, or the working class? So if so, where do you position her is a good question to start with. Then you see, we also have this question of the inheritance laws at that time, the legal rights. And again, going back and reading the context, the social context of the period, you would know that it was generally the men who were the heirs or the ones who got the inheritance. It was not the women. And also a married man could not just, you know, not give his inheritance to a wife, because if he was legally married to her, it belonged to her. So you see, there are two things that are happening here in the novel. Again, in the novel, interestingly enough, one of the first things that happens is John Reed tells Jane that she is a dependent. I've taken this from the book. So he says that, you know, you have no right to take any of the books, you are a dependent. And that word, the dependent, I think strikes home to her to a large extent. Because continuously her struggle throughout the novel is that she doesn't want to be a dependent. And this question of the legal rights enters even into her marriage. Because when she was supposed to get married and she got to know that Rochester was already married, she had to actually look at the fact that, you know, she could not marry him in spite of the fact he told her a large number of things with regard to his feelings towards her. Because she felt that if she did, she would be participating just like other women in another emotional quotient, and she would not be resisting him. So she thinks that, you know, her need at the moment is to actually break away from the whole thing. Again, in chapters 27, these lines are there. She says that laws and principles are more important, are not for the times where there is no temptation. They are for such moments as this, when body and soul rise in mutiny against their vigor. So she places a lot of emphasis on this. And she also says preconceived opinions, foregone determinations, are all I have at this art to stand by. There I plant my foot. And the reason is that she doesn't want to be secondary. She wants to be the primary. So you see, again, we look at the social context of laws, and we look at how Jane is fashioned in the novel. Then there are autobiographical elements. You see, I just gave you a picture. I do not want you to, you know, look at all that and discuss. But so the fact is that there were so many children. And by the time Charlotte Bronte writes the novel, in fact, you know, there are only three children that are living. That is Charlotte, Emily, and Jane. And Charlotte is the only survivor for a long time because everybody else passes away. Of course, the same picture in a different way I put up there. But there is also the autobiographical fact of, you know, the fact that to a large extent, both the Bronte sisters, when they fashioned Rochester and Heathcliff, they fashioned it after their brother, Patrick Bronte, who was quite abusive, violent, a seducer, who embezzled money, and they saw a lot of this that came up in their lives. Similarly, they were also from an Irish background, and in the small community that they lived, there are stories that they were alienated. The family was not seen as participant in the community. So you see, drawing from the autobiographic elements, we can also see where Jane Eyre comes from. So what is it that Charlotte Bronte brings from her background into the novel? So these are interesting things that give you. And then, of course, you know, Gaskell herself, who wrote to us in one of her letters, she also claims that Branwell, you know, had an incestuous problem. And that was the model for Heathcliff, Rochester, and others in the novels. But we are not so sure whether that was true, because now you have to go back and ask the students to dig up various reports and see whether really, you know, the claim was true. Whether incest was true. So now I looked at the social patterns. I will also look at the cultural context of the times. You see, we also look at the family and the way of life at which, you know, the stories were being set. The class system in the society. As I already told you, there was a large amount of class system. Where does Jane belong? Where does Mrs. Reed belong? Where does Jane's Rochester belong? So, you know, if you look at it, you find that there are different elements. So can there be social mobility is a question. How does that work in the novel? What is the question about religion in the novel? Does it seem to in any way say that you need to be religious, you need to be virtuous, you need to be good, you need to go to church? What are the contexts that it brings out in the novel? Then is there any kind of scientific temperament in the novel? Is there any kind of rational reasoning, objectivity, any of those, do they come up in the novel? Are there gender roles that are very stereotypical? Or are they not stereotypical? And then, you know, questions, of course, you know, which I took all these. If you look at that Britannica.com that I've given you the link there, almost all these are given to you in the backdrop of the Victorian period. What was the type of families that were there? What was the class system? What was the religion? Taking that as a background, you go back and start digging into the novel. You start investigating. You start probing. And you find that probably there are things that are very different from the normative. Why is it then the novelist is doing these kinds of things? So these are the questions that teachers should be asking. So, you know, then we move to something like, you know, the question also of reading, writing and knowledge. Because at the time that we are looking at, there is an emphasis from the beginning of the novel on library and sitting and reading. And you go back and look, there is a backdrop that education for governesses began to improve, you know, in 1848 with founding of the Queen's College and then the Cheltenham Ladies College. And there was an emphasis that governesses had to be educated. So now we are also discussing the fact that people coming from the backdrop of working class or maybe who wanted to be governesses had to have education. It was not so much of a necessity for people who were just going to be housewives, which also means that Jane is being fashioned to be a governess from the beginning of the novel. And that emphasis on education is there in the novel to a large extent because female bonding and education are coupled in the novel. The first instance is of Helen Burns in the school. And, you know, Jane asks her, you must wish to leave Lowood. And Helen says, I was sent to Lowood to get an education. And then she also makes another statement that heathens and savage tribes hold the doctrine, but Christians and civilized disown it, making the statement that those who get educated also become refined and civilized. A little later in the novel, Miss Temple is another example, because Miss Temple provides the backdrop saying that she is a teacher to serve whose kingdom is not of the world. My mission is to mortify in these girls the lusts of the flesh, to teach them, you know, how to live life, not, you know, to explain to them how to clothe themselves, how to plate themselves, or how to show of their vanity. That is not my work, she says. And then, you know, Miss Temple also provides a lot of instruction and friendship and society to the whole picture of the normative, you know. She provides that basic background for showing Jane how a good mother, how a good governess and a good companion could be there. So Jane derives a lot from Miss Temple, and this programs itself, you know, into the Reed's family, that is John Reed, her cousin, and her two women cousins, because the two women cousins and she start learning how education could be a very active and faithful component. Because it means that, you know, she also tells you that she teaches rural farmers' children who have no knowledge of education. But over a period of time, she recognizes that they have learned to read and write and to become polite, to have self-respect and to understand the modalities that education can provide for refinement. So in a way, reading, writing and knowledge are emphasized in the novel. And, you know, this is something you should program the students to look at, because this is an important facet of almost all the novels that are written in that during that time. It somehow means to say that all the authors who are writing placed an emphasis on education as being important. So now we also move to question of intellectualism, because the ability to think or discuss also means not just intelligence, it also means working within the notion of reason and rationale, working without emotions or feelings. So you see that we are looking at intellectualism that is derived from the novel, where Jane, by the time the novel ends, is shown to us as an intellectual. You know, I think I'll just skip this slide. So now the preface to the novel, if you look at the preface to the novel, she has written a preface. It's very interesting that she provides the preface by saying that one of the statements that she states is that conventionality is not morality. So the novel is trying to, you know, pick or in a way, you know, remove conventional modes and try to, you know, redeem for you a kind of process by which it is trying to progress, or give you an ideology by which it is trying to tell you that the novel is not the normal fixated one of the Victorian period. It has been trying to, you know, remove a large number of things that are participative of the Victorian society. I'll just take 5 more minutes and complete. Then we have the question of the genre itself. What kind of a novel is this? Is this an autobiography? Then if it is an autobiography, it fails at many times because it is also providing pictures of various kinds to you at various times. Is it a gothic? There are a lot of gothic tropes. Does it mean that it is gothic? There is also the question of whether it's a Bildungsroman. If so, has it succeeded, is a question. So these are pointers by which you should be pointing it out to the students to ask and find out, you know, whether these are things that are working in the novel. You can also ask them if they think that it can belong to some other kind of genre. Can it be a romance? Can it be a fairy tale? Can it be sensational? Then, you know, the theoretical frameworks. Finally, you know, this is what you would be doing at a higher level. You ask them whether, you know, you can fit the work into a post-colonial model. Do you think that the storyline can fit into post-colonialism? Do you think using Bertha Mason there, can it be post-colonial? Can the novel be called feminist? Do you think that Jane is a feminist? Does she fight for women's rights? Is she self-assertive? Does she make her own life? Is there any kind of notion of the subaltern? Are there people who are looked at as subaltern in the novel? What about, you know, the workers who are house helps that are there in the novel? What positions do they take? So the need for pedagogy, why do we actually need to have pedagogy is that, as I told you, social pedagogy, or, you know, it educates the students towards social development, well-being, using fiction. One can explain to a student the personality, the growth of personality, moral values, ethics, how to belong into a community, what is important for one to belong. Then critical pedagogy to tell them how to, you know, look at topics. Topics like education, how can education refine you? What is the modus operandi of education? How can reading be a good thing? How can, you know, looking at women be looked at as respect or self-reliant? How can we look at this? Then questioning, you know, diverse societies, trying to tell them how, you know, diversity works. How do we use institutions? How do we use the personal? How do we use instructional? Teach them the differences. Can Jane Eyre work in Indian context? Is it only participant in the English context? Can we remodel her in the indigenous manner? Do we have this kind of examples? So you see, I finally come to the statement of trying to tell you that whatever I work today towards with was trying to make you to think about, you know, explaining and understanding that novels can open a large number of dimensions. It's not that novels have only one dimension. They have innumerable things. But as I told you, it also means a lot of work from us teachers. It's not easy to teach because it means the dedicated work for at least 3 to 4 hours to find out the social context, the cultural context, to read in between the lines, to find out what you can ask the students and make them think. So I think that is what I wanted to do today in the, you know, the present lecture. I hope I've given all of you something to think about. I thank each of you for your patience to listening to me. And today, my lecture is dedicated to my students all over who have made learning and teaching for me fun. If I have been able to be a good teacher, it is only because of the give and take I've enjoyed with my students. Thank you, and please, it's open for any questions, comments, suggestions of any kind. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Kalpana, for that enlightening lecture. And now I ask one of your own students to moderate the Q&A session. Dr. Karthika, take over.
The person is Ms. Rajana, and she has said it's really an enlightening session. And her question is, can comparative study of literature to its adaptation in another medium like film or TV serials or comics or an animation, can they enhance and influence students' attraction to literature? Can we use this medium to teach them?
Yes, absolutely. You see, it's very interesting. You see, when you actually use films, for example, I keep telling students this, when I teach Pride and Prejudice, I really enjoy looking at the film adaptations. And, you know, if you have looked at the film adaptations of the films, it's very interesting, that the directors use many things that are there and they also remove many things that are there. One of the examples in JNIR, one adaptation, if I remember correctly, it has removed the John Reed's two sisters from the film. And that I found extremely interesting, because I thought, at least at a personal level, I thought having the sisters helped a lot, because it shaped Jane in a certain way. And removing them in a way, changed the pattern of the structure of thought that, Bronte was making. Similarly, in Pride and Prejudice, I always thought that one of the key components was the time when she runs, about 5 miles to meet her sister Elizabeth. And I thought when she goes with her dirty petticoats and all that, that was one model where she showed her independence and said that she doesn't bother about the present context in which she was placed. And again, I found that interesting that in the Keira Knightley, the last adaptation, that part was totally taken out. And I felt really bad, because I thought that gave, in a way, the whole idea of what kind of a woman Elizabeth was in just one small shot. And that, for some reason, was effectively removed. So I do think that, films and adaptations and looking at them provide a very interesting methodology for teaching, definitely.
Thank you, ma'am. There are no other questions as of now. I'm sure that it was a very clear presentation. I totally enjoyed it, ma'am. It was going back to your class once again. Such a bliss.
Somebody has asked that, on how to help students write critically. Yes, I think, it also means that it is, to a certain extent, giving a lot of work to the students. You need not give big assignments, small, short, one paragraph questions, which they can answer even in 200 words, for example, which can make them think. For example, what do you think of this particular statement in the novel? What do you think about it? You just ask them these kind of small things and ask them to write even some 200 words. I think that should start them to write in their own way and critically engage with the text. It's only, when you are having bigger assignments that students really have a problem to answer. When you give them short things, many times students are ready to take that up and answer.
Ma'am, just one question came up. Can you please point out some group activities that can help students to understand fiction better, especially short stories?
I would say that, I would ask, for example, if I have to teach in one of my Canadian fiction classes, a short story called A Snow by F.P. Grove. This story is so bleak, and it is also a story that, if you read the story, you feel it's not a story, it's more like a sketch. But, when I actually taught it in the class, I asked the students to go back and, work in groups and tell me. One group, I asked them to get me the pictures or images of snow that they have encountered in different kinds of works. And, then I had so many pictures. They brought out a poem from Frost. They brought out from somebody else. And then, they looked at it. Then I asked another group to find out if they remembered any films or any shots from films or videos or anything that showed snow and how did they look at it. I asked another group to find out if by chance they were placed in such a kind of situation where there's so much of desolation, how would they look at it? So these kind of programs allowed them to, you know, come up with various ideas. And then I went back to the story. When I went back to the story, they were able to easily relate to it. So this is how generally we, I think group work can work. It does mean, you know, it's a lot of noise in a classroom, regular classroom. Now, you know, on the online, many of these like Google Meet have classrooms. So you can use the classrooms to work out these kind of group sessions. So that would be my answer.
A minor modification to Dr. Kalpana's humble confession in the beginning, saying that her lecture may be useful perhaps only to postgraduate, to teach postgraduate sessions or graduate sessions like that. But I would say that all those things Dr. Kalpana stated are applicable to teaching of fiction at any level. All those things can be simply cut and pasted at the lower levels as well. Whether one teaches Arke Narayan in class 9, or say Tom Sawyer or something like that in class 11 or like that. Maybe except the last few things like post-colonialism. Even there, elements like feminism can be easily conveyed to lower levels as well. 20 years, I know Dr. Kalpana. 12 years I worked with Dr. Kalpana. I knew her passion for teaching. Within the passion for teaching, passion for literature. Within the passion for literature, passion for fiction. I used to glance into her classroom while passing through the corridors, and I simply envied her popularity among her students. I think I didn't go wrong in inviting a literature person and request her to add a pedagogic element to her passion of literature. I hope all of you will agree with me. This is a wonderful session on the pedagogy of literature in general and fiction in particular. Thank you,
Dr. Kalpana. I must thank you all for giving me this opportunity. I enjoyed it so much. I can't tell you how good it was for me to be here with you. Thank you so much. Thanks.
What better words than we need than the confession by your own colleague? And how much you appreciated it. Madam, it was really interesting. You all enjoyed the session. Here's another student of yours, Ms. Bhagyalakshmi. She is a faculty of Bharatidasan College for Women, Puducherry. And she'll now formally thank you and the participants.
Very warm good evening to one and all. We have successfully come to the end of the 14th lecture organized by LTIF as a part of its lecture series. It is indeed a privilege and pleasure for me to propose the vote of thanks on behalf of LTIF. Today, we were very fortunate to have Professor H. Kalpana with us, and it is always a pleasure listening to Professor H. Kalpana. And as a proud student, I would like to add that our favorite teacher knows well to make her students think perfectly and write logically. And let me come to my duty. I would like to extend our deepest sense of gratitude on behalf of LTIF to Professor H. Kalpana for such an interesting lecture on the topic, Pedagogical Aspects of Teaching Fiction in the Second Language Classroom. Her lecture that focused on teaching novel in classrooms by explaining pedagogy, second language learning, and fiction clearly was really enlightening. In her lecture, ma'am seems to reject the conventional method of teaching and looked at the text Jane Eyre to talk about the ways through which the art of teaching can be changed. Thank you very much, ma'am, for providing us with the ideas of rereading the text by focusing on the plot construction, perspectives of certain characters and writers, writer, characterization, setting, evaluating the context and individuals, legal rights at that point of time, run theoretical framework, social and cultural context that might have fashioned the characters. A lecture that focuses on the notion of dialogism the novel can critically create was really helpful for us. Thank you very much, ma'am. The leadership and dedication of Professor Bhaskaran Nair is the driving force behind this organization. His indomitable spirit and his constant support and guidance always inspire us. I would like to thank him for his constant support and encouragement. Dr. C. Praveen is the coordinator of the online lecture series. His ideal way of organizing by paying attention to even minute details is commendable. Thank you, sir, for coordinating this lecture series and supporting us. I would also like to thank committee members, Dr. A.C. Srihari, Dr. Kartika V.K., Mr. P. Mohanan, Mr. Olsen Panoli, Dr. A.K. Leena, Mrs. Vinija, Dr. Sajida Sultana, Ms. Lakshmi Suresh, for working together to make the program successful. And last but not least, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to all the participants for your active participation and interaction. We expect your cooperation in the future endeavors. And once again, I would like to thank you all for the successful conduct of the program. Thank you.